Hey everybody, this Blender tutorial is going to be different than what you're used to finding on YouTube. This is a relatively simple disintegration effect. I learned it from Ducky3D, but I made a few changes. He credits BBN19 for showing it to him on Twitter. Others have demonstrated similar effects. I want to take a different approach to explaining this because it uses some shading nodes and some animation effects. For every single step in the process, I'm going to thoroughly explain what it is we're doing and exactly why we are doing it. I really hope this format is useful for beginners. It builds upon my introduction to shading tutorial, but this will probably be excruciatingly slow for advanced users, so it's not for everybody. Fire up Blender to follow along. Let's go. Before we start to add our procedural disintegration effect in Blender, we need to add a base material to the object. This can be any material you want. Creating this material is not the focus of the tutorial. This is actually a material from a material pack I picked up somewhere. I'll link to my favorite packs of 3D materials in the description. Please take a look at them if you're interested. I'm using Eevee as my render engine. The important part here is that once we have a principled BSDF shader plugged into the material output node, we are going to add our disintegration or dissolving effect to the material by adding some nodes in the shader editor. So I have the Suzanne Monkey object selected. It has a subdivision surface modifier added to it, and it is set to shade smooth. I have only one material on this object. I have that material selected, and I'm in the shader editor. Also, make sure this Use Nodes button is turned on. Note that adding this effect using this method is only going to work if we have a single material on the object, because we are adding the effect to this particular material. There are other methods to disintegrate an entire object, but they are a little bit more complex. So again, whatever material you have on the object, we are going to work in between this principled BSDF output and the final material output node. The first step is to add a mix shader between the principled BSDF and the material output node. Press Shift A and type in mix. We want the mix shader, not the mix node. The mix node is for combining colors and other data, and we will actually use it later in this tutorial, but the mix shader takes the completed output of one shader and mixes it with the completed output of another shader. Place the mix shader between the principled shader and the final material output node. The noodle from the principled shader will plug into one of the green input sockets of the mix shader. It doesn't really matter which one, but for consistency, let's all plug it into the top one. Otherwise, a lot of settings we're going to cover later will need to be inverted. So what the mix shader does is it takes inputs from two shaders. That means what could be two completely separate materials that are plugged into the two green input sockets on the left of it. Then it combines them, and how they're combined is determined by this factor input at the top. The factor input is gray because it accepts black and white, grayscale, or numeric data. It will ignore any color data. The mix shader spits out the combination of shaders on the right, which we will feed into our final material output. The reason we are plugging this material into the mix shader is because we will mix it with a transparent material. That's an invisible material. So step two is adding a transparent shader. Press Shift A again to add a node and search for transparent to find the transparent BSDF shader. Drag the green output from the transparent shader into the second green input on the mix shader. Now we have two complete shaders indicated by green sockets getting mixed together based on the factor of this mix shader. Because we are using Eevee and using transparency, there is a step we have to take to activate the transparency. We would not need to do this in cycles. By default, Eevee doesn't recognize transparency, at least not the way we want it to. So go to the Properties panel, and in the Material Properties tab, this is where properties for the selected material are, scroll down to find the Settings tab and change the blend mode from opaque to alpha hashed. This is a technical setting to tell Blender that this material has transparency and we want it recognized. In the Ducky 3D tutorial I mentioned earlier, he uses Alpha Blend, which is usually what I use, but he also had to turn on the backface culling, which makes the back of the materials invisible. I didn't want that, so I found using Alpha Hashed and leaving the backface culling unchecked gave me the effect I wanted in the end. Let's go back and see what our two shaders mixed together look like now, and I'm going to be in rendered preview mode. By default, we have a 50-50 mix of our original material and the transparent shader. So it's basically our original material, but it's 50% transparent, and so we can kind of see through it. So now we want to control where the transparency is placed. We don't want a 50-50 mix like we have right now. We essentially want a movable line drawn straight down the center of the monkey, and we want our base material on one side and the transparency on the other side. And all of that is going to be controlled through this factor input. So what we're going to do is we're going to add a gradient texture. Press Shift A and search for gradient. Place the gradient texture and drag from one of the outputs into the factor input of the mix shader. You'll notice this gradient output has a yellow color output socket and a gray factor output. The yellow is designed to include color information. The gray is for the basic value information, including black, white, or grayscale. In this case, either one will actually work. The gray socket will just ignore the color information. Drag from one of them to the factor input of the mix shader. Now the mix shader is starting to receive information from the gradient texture about how to mix our original shader and the transparent shader together. But all it really knows right now is it's supposed to be a gradient. Let's use some more nodes to give it more information on how we want this gradient to appear. First, let's get some control over the location of the gradient. We do that by adding two nodes, a mapping node and a texture coordinate node. The mapping node has all the controls for mapping the gradient. The texture coordinate node instructs Blender to map the textures in a certain way. If you have watched my Intro to Shading series, you know that with the Node Wrangler add-on activated, you can select the gradient texture node and press Ctrl-T on the keyboard to automatically add both. But we want to make one little change. The texture coordinate node has all these different ways a texture can be mapped, and for what we are trying to do, we want it mapped based on the shape of the actual object. So we're going to choose Object and connect that object socket to the vector input socket of the mapping node, instead of the default generated up on top. Now we notice a more clear gradient across the object. The material is solid on this side, completely transparent on this side, and there's a vertical gradient that occurs in the middle. The texture coordinate node is saying, generate a map of this texture based on the object's shape. The mapping node controls that map's position. The gradient node says the texture is going to be in the form of a linear gradient. And then it goes into the mix node to tell Blender how to mix the two shaders together. If we go to the mapping node, we can control the location of the gradient by adjusting along the appropriate axis. We can rotate the gradient. And with the scale settings, we can control how spread out the gradient is. We can also invert it by using negative numbers. But there's actually a better way to control this particular aspect of the gradient, and it's with a color ramp node. Press Shift A and search for a color ramp node. Place it between the gradient texture and the mix shader. This node is another type of gradient node and is one of the most commonly used nodes. It takes the information from the gradient and fine-tunes how the exact transition between black and white is to occur. Again, it has both a color output and alpha output. But for what we are doing, it doesn't matter which one we use. By default, the color ramp has two positions on this slider. The positions control how the gradient escalates from one value to another, in this case from black to white. Black is representing where one material will be, and white is representing where the other material will be when this information is fed into the mix shader. If we click and drag these closer together, we condense the transitional space of the gradient. If we slide one past the other, the gradient will flip. Let's just set it right around here for now. Now we want to add some emission to where the gradient transitions. Stay with me. To do this, we are going to actually go to the principled BSDF shader, which creates our base material. A little side note, if the base material is already using emission, this might not work on that particular material. We are going to add another color ramp. Press Shift A and search for color ramp. Place it and drag the color output socket into the emission input socket for the principled shader. This time, it is important that we use the color output and not the alpha because we will be adding actual color to the emission this time. Right now, what this is doing is adding black and white emission to the base material. But black emission isn't possible because it has a value of 0, so it's just white. But we are going to have this emission color follow a similar mapping pattern to the gradient texture we used above. To do that, we go back up to the gradient and again click the yellow output socket. Then drag to connect it to the input of the new color ramp node. Let's adjust this new color ramp so the emission it puts out is a little bit more obvious. Let's drag the black in just a little bit and drag the white much closer to the black. We are manipulating how and where the gradient occurs, but only for the emission of this shader, not with the rest of the information that goes up and into the mix shader over here. It's a little more obvious where the white emission is now. Let's make it more obvious by turning up the emission strength right here. There are a couple other settings I want to turn on, so this emission is a little bit more obvious. Go to the Render Properties tab. Check the box next to Bloom. This will turn on the glowing effect, which is known as Bloom. Trust me, it'll look really cool later. Also, Screen Space Reflections is generally a good thing to activate. It basically just turns on reflections in the viewport. Okay, so let's go back to our shader editor. Oh, and if you like the pace of this video so far or have found it helpful, please take a moment to hit that like button. It's all the thanks I ask for. Now, let's choose the color of the emission. To do that, we left-click on this white control point. Remember, black, when dealing with emission, is 0. So the only color emitting is this white, and we can change that. With the white selected, left-click on the white color below. click around on the color picker to choose the color you want for the emission. We can increase the emission strength on the principled BSDF shader by increasing the emission strength value here. Make it as high as you want. We can always come back and adjust all of these settings later. So let's recap what we have going on right here, from left to right as the information flows through this node tree. The texture coordinate says I want the following textures to be mapped to whichever object it's applied to. Then we have the mapping node, which controls where that mapping is assigned, and it gives us controls to move it around or rotate it. The map is told to be applied to a gradient texture here. The output of that gradient is then sent to two different places. It goes into this color ramp, which will eventually control how the base material is mixed with the transparent material. And it also goes down into this color ramp, which will control where the emission is going to be. This bottom color ramp is generating the emission color, and it's also making that emission kind of turn into a gradient. This color ramp is plugged into the mix shader, which combines the two shaders, that is our base material shader and the transparent or the invisible shader. The mix shader then mixes the two based off the information provided by this color ramp and everything else behind it. Then it plugs into the final output. All right, but let's just keep going. We don't want a straight transition like this. Well, if you do, I guess you're done. But if we want to add some distortion to this perfectly straight emissive line, we are going to do that way back here in between the texture coordinate and the mapping node. Whatever we place here will affect everything in the node tree from here on forward. Let's press Shift A and search for a noise texture. A noise texture generates randomness. Place it here between the texture coordinate and the mapping node. Everything will disappear right now because the information doesn't make sense to Blender. But now we can add a mix node. Press Shift A and search for mix. And this time, yes, we are going to use the mix node, not the mix shader. That's because we are not mixing two shaders together right now. Place it after the noise texture. A mix node can mix different types of data, and it defaults to float, which is a form of numerical data. We want to change this to color. You might think we want vector data because we're plugging this yellow into a purple right here, and that's a little unconventional, but in this case, it's all right. Okay, so when we change it to color, it disconnects the node for some reason. Plug it back together the way we had it, and then there's one more step here. Drag the object output from the texture coordinate and mix it into the second color input on this mix node. Look at what this has done. It's mixing the noise into the texture coordinate info. This factor slider on the mix node can adjust how much noise is mixed into it. If we place it at 1, it's 0 noise. Place it at 0, and it's all noise. Somewhere in between is probably what we want. And again, we can always go back and change all these little adjustments to fine-tune our end result. For example, I may want to go back over here and make this transition a little tighter. Okay, back to the noise texture we placed here near the beginning. We can play around with these other settings to adjust the look of this randomized distortion that's now appearing in our gradient. Add detail with the detail setting, play with the scale to adjust the size of the distortion, and you can play around with these other settings. And if you ever want to reset the default settings of a single node, select the node and go to the node menu here, and then just choose Reset Node. Do you remember how to control the movement of the transition across the object? It's done with the mapping node. Because of the way this is oriented, moving the X location on the mapping node will move this effect across the Suzanne monkey this way. Remember, we can rotate it, and I think a little rotation on the Y axis actually looks pretty good. Oh, one other thing I forgot to mention. Let's go back over to the color ramp node that controls the color of our emission. We can add additional stops to this by pressing the plus icon. See, now a new stop on this slider has been added. Click on the new stop and we can change it to another color, and we can move it around. Now we have these two colors visible in the emission. We can actually do this several times to make very unique effects. But then add another one and keep it black. Place it a little ways out to tighten up the transition. The markers on this color ramp and their respective colors are actually represented inside the emission. This just might be something you have to play around with. So now, how do we animate this effect moving across our object? Well, we do it by placing keyframes on the settings of the mapping node. And this isn't intended to be an introduction to animation, but I will walk through the step-by-step process of adding these keyframes and explain as I go. So what we need here is a timeline editor. Click down in the bottom left corner of the shader editor and drag up to create a new editor screen. Then I'll click the top left icon in this new screen to get this menu. I'm going to choose timeline under animation. This timeline allows us to move forward and backwards in our animation. Go to the frame where we want the animation to start. For example, right now, I'll just go to frame 10. I can drag this along the timeline, or I can just type in the number 10 in this box. Now go to the mapping node. move the effect along the x-axis so it's completely invisible and we only see the base material. But stop just after you get there. If you ever need to make fine adjustments to this, hold shift while you left click and drag on this box. It'll just move in slower increments. Or use the arrows on either side to move incrementally. Then hover the cursor over the X location setting and press I on the keyboard. These boxes have turned yellow, indicating the setting has an active keyframe. What that means will make more sense in just a minute. Now on the timeline, we need to move to where, or really when, we want the effect to stop transitioning. For example, if I want the disintegration effect to last 60 frames, I will go to frame 70. That's 60 frames after frame 10, which is where I started. Now back to the mapping node. See these boxes have turned green? That means there's a keyframe assigned to them, but not on the current frame. The keyframe I assigned was on frame 10, and now we're on frame 70. Let's change the x-axis setting now, so that the transition slides all the way across the object, and now the object is completely invisible. Stop just after it becomes invisible. Again, we will hover over the X location on the mapping setting and press I on the keyboard. This will add a second keyframe to the current frame for this value setting. What we've done is placed a keyframe on frame 10 and told Blender we want the animation to start at that setting on the frame. Then on frame 70, we want it to end at this setting. Blender will transition between the two settings over the course of 60 frames. Click this back button on the timeline to go to the beginning of the animation. Then press the play button and we see it. That's pretty cool. I'm also going to animate one other part of this. Remember on the mix node we added way over here, how the factor setting controls how spread out the disintegration effect is? Well, I want it to start out narrow and actually grow as it crosses over the Suzanne. So on frame 10, I'm going to slide it all the way to 1, or at least very close to 1, and then place a keyframe just as we did before, by hovering over the value and pressing I on the keyboard. Then I'll go to frame 70 and move this down. Not quite all the way down, but about here. Then hover over this setting and add another keyframe. It's a subtle change, but now as the disintegration effect moves across the monkey, it actually spreads out, and I think that's pretty cool. So in this tutorial, we took a basic material and we added this disintegration effect to it, and then we animated it. Great job. I will link to a step-by-step companion guide for this video, which is available on my website, brandonsdrawings.com. I hope this excruciatingly slow format helped somebody out. Please, throw me a like if it did, let me know what you thought in the comments, and why not, just hit the subscribe button. That way you'll make sure to see the next one. Oh, and don't forget, stay creative.